Hello, and welcome to the fourth in our seven-part series on Windows Server 2012 R2, The Essentials Experience, where we'll be talking about the features and functionality that were previously only available in the Essentials Edition, but are now available as a role in the Standard and Data Center Editions as well. So today we'll talk about management and monitoring of the server. So to get started, let's take a quick look at our agenda. We'll start out talking about the different ways that you can monitor the health of the server and the client computers in the Essentials environment. Then we'll talk about the various backup and restore options that you have, and look at managing the server storage. And we'll also take a little bit of time here to talk about storage spaces and how that can be used as part of your strategy. And then finally, we'll look at creating the shared folders on the server. So a pretty simple operation, and hopefully this will give you a good sense of managing and monitoring the server. So we'll start out by taking a look at some of the health monitoring that's available. And really what we've done is to try to make this as easy as possible for customers and the partners that support them to be able to, on a proactive basis, monitor the status of the servers in the environment as well as the client computers in the environment, so that you know that they have the security updates that they need, the various other updates that they may need to have, and just make sure that the environment as a whole is healthy. So we report on a basic, you know, three-tiered alerting level. So you have informational alerts, warning, and critical. And then for each alert, you'd see also not just that there is an alert, but actually some prescriptive guidance that helps to work out a resolution to the issue. And many alerts actually have an active link in the description that will take you right to the resources or the tools that you need to address the problem that that you're seeing. We have an integrated health reporting aspect, so you can choose to automatically generate and then email the reports on a daily basis to whatever email address you want. So this can be somebody internal to the organization. Again, this can be a partner that supporting the environment, and so this is a great way to just see on a daily basis whether you have you know, all green checks for good health, or if there is some kind of warning or some kind of critical alert that you might need to do something about right away. Another aspect of health monitoring in the Essentials environment is that it is extensible. So there's a number of opportunities to extend the Essentials experience to third-party developers and different add-ins from Microsoft. And then these different aspects, these different pieces of functionality, can also report their health status, and that will bubble up in the exact same health reporting infrastructure that the Essentials provides. So as you look in the dashboard and see the different alerts that you have, this has now been moved. It used to be a dialog box that that would kind of pop up, but now it's a sub-tab on the home tab. So you can now see these a little bit more integrated into the dashboard itself, and the tasks that you have available are presented in the same way that tasks are presented throughout the dashboard. So this is a little bit more of a consistent look and feel. Now, when you see the alerts in the dashboard, they're going to be grouped by severity. So you see the critical ones at the top and the informational ones at the bottom. There's alerting across the entire kind of breadth of the health scope of the server and client PCs. You'll see alerts about things like status of the firewall, if you don't have the group policy implemented and somebody's turned off the firewall on their client PC, for example, you would see that bubble up as an alert in the dashboard. Similarly with the anti-malware status. Also, you'll see things like software update status. So if a client computer needs an update or needs to be rebooted after an update, then you'd see that in the dashboard, as well as things like disk space utilization. So as your storage is coming up to its full capacity, you'll start to see alerts in the dashboard to let you know that it's time to add some additional disk space, for example. When you're seeing the icon of what alert is active, and you can see this at the top of the dashboard, regardless of the page that you're on, there's a little icon here on the screen. There's a little red X with a little number one next to it, up by the settings. And what you'll see as far as the icon goes is just the most severe status indicator. So if you only have a warning, then you'd see the yellow exclamation point and so on. some alerts in the environment may be things that you just need to be alerted about, but don't necessarily need or want to deal with right away. As an example, you might have an alert that says, hey, I have an extra hard drive and you haven't allocated me yet. And you know that's the case and you're planning on doing something with it. You just want to ignore the alert. It's not something that you need to be told about all the time. So you can do that, and you can re-enable or reactivate alerts later on as well. So there's some flexibility in how much nagging the alerts do for you. The idea, of course, is that they want to provide you with the information that you need to keep the environment healthy. So, as I mentioned, you can generate a health report. You can generate reports on demand, and you can also set up a schedule so that they're automatically created. You can customize the contents of the report. Typically, you might you know, as a partner monitoring the environment for a customer, you probably have all the sections turned on. But if there's some aspect of it that, say, the business owner has expressed interest in, he's very curious about the you know, the backup status and wants to make sure that the backup happened right away. So you could just tailor the report to show just the server backup status and have that emailed to the business owner. And that way, for example, that she knows that everything is completely fine and backed up and all the data is safe and secure and the business is secure in its data. As you send reports through email, you can send them to any recipient. It's not limited to just the folks inside the environment, but again, it can be anyone that you want to receive the report. We also have integration with the best practices analyzer. So this is being integrated and exposed more through the server manager console across all the editions of Windows Server. So in the past, it was necessary to download the best practice analyzer or the BPA separately. And now that's no longer the case because it's integrated right into Windows Server. We have over 60 rules that are checked during each scan of the BPA to let you know what's going on. These have actually been refined and consolidated from the past, so there used to be more maybe a little bit more noise in terms of what information that you really needed. So we continue to both expand and shrink the set of rules and refine them to really hone in on what is important for you to maintain a healthy system. So if there are errors or warnings that the BPA comes across, then of course those are going to generate alerts that you'll see then in the dashboard. So it's not necessary to come to the server manager console separately in order to find out the results of the BPA, but you can hone in on specific details of each alert by coming to the server manager console and seeing those. And again, this is going to give you information about the alert, so not just the fact that there was one, but actually give you some guidance and some links on how to address the issue. So that's a little bit about monitoring in the environment. Again, the idea is to give you some proactive tools so that you get alerts of situations before people are calling you on the phone or sending you angry emails. The next thing that I wanted to talk about is just your basic backup and restore capabilities. So things kind of start out with server backup. This is a feature that has been around in Essentials. It's been in SBS before that, and of course is in Windows Server, all the editions as well. And it's just a great way to protect the entire server. So you can, in the dashboard, in the Essentials environment, you can add drives to the server backup list of destinations. So as you add, you know, as you connect new storage to the server, you'll get an alert that says, hey, I have new storage, what would you like me to do with it? And you can go to the Storage tab and the Hard Drive sub-tab, and you can designate hard drives to be used for server backup. So these can be internal drives, but we recommend that they would be external drives that you can remove, so like USB type drives. And really the idea is that you would have multiple drives designated as backup destinations so that you can rotate them and you can take them off-site. And this just gives you, you know, additional layers of data protection, especially if you move them off-site. You know, in small environments, administrators, you can just take them home. In slightly larger environments, you know, maybe you have a safety deposit box at a nearby bank or something like this. And again, it just gives you that additional peace of mind to know that you have a complete backup that you can use to restore your business data, files and folders, as well as the entire server. So it backs up the system state so that you can do a complete bare metal restore if that's needed as well. So this is actually one of the most powerful aspects of using the server backup. And there are additional backup choices that you have to complement this, but this is the one that allows you to perform a full restore of the server. So as you go through the setup wizard that sets up server backup, it allows you to do the things that you would expect as far as designating which backup destination drives that you want to use, what schedule you want to run it on, and of course what items that you want to protect. Now, in the past, in the way back days when we were using tapes and things like that, and backup was slow and it ran overnight and it basically brought the server to its knees, you would only back up once a day. You'd back up after business hours, and you would do some kind of grandfather, father, son rotation, and you do full backups every once in a while, and you do incremental backups or differential backups or this or that or whatever you would do. And it was all a little bit confusing. The way server backup works today with backing up to hard drive destinations, it's much, much quicker. And so in terms of setting up a backup schedule, it's much more realistic to do backups even throughout the day. So the first time a particular backup destination device is used, all the active blocks, all the used blocks on the server are going to get copied to that destination. And so that initial run can take a considerable amount of time. But then on an ongoing basis, as that same destination device is used over and over again, it will only need to copy over or back up the changed blocks on the source server, on your central server, and store those on the backup destination. This allows you to restore a particular file or folder at pretty much any point in time that it has blocks that were saved across any number of different backups that were made, up to and including the entire server itself. But because it's only going to back up the blocks that have changed from what it already has, this means it's very efficient and it can take up less disk space on the destination device, as well as just running very quickly. So the idea that you could run a backup in the middle of the day at 10 o'clock in the morning or 2 o'clock in the afternoon and really not impact the end users at all gives you a really robust way to protect your data and to be able to restore information in a shorter window of time so that you can get back to a more recent backup of a file that may have been worked on throughout the day. So just kind of my take on the modern backup destination methodology that we can take advantage of today. So in terms of backing up the data, that's all very well and good, but really the only thing that you end up caring about is whether or not you can restore your data later. So I highly encourage you to periodically test restore. That's always a great idea, but knowing what you can restore and how that works is really the most important part of backups. So you are able to, with the Essentials backup UI here, you're able to restore again from the most recent backup or any date and time that you've run a backup to the particular backup destination that you're using to do restores. You can recover individual files, of course, you can recover entire folders, and you can recover entire volumes. In fact, you can, of course, as I've mentioned, perform a complete bare metal restore of the entire server. And in order to do that, it's actually fairly straightforward. You just boot from the installation media that you use to install the server. That came with the server that you purchased or that you bought later, whatever the case may be. Then you choose, instead of I want to install my server, you choose the option in the lower left corner that says I want to repair my server. And you can then choose the option to restore the server, and that would let you basically restore to a completely blank new hard drive. You can also create a bootable USB recovery media, and that will again let you basically, what you boot into is the Windows pre-installation environment, or the WinPE, and that lets you restore to your hard drives. Now, if you bought your server from an OEM, they can provide kind of a factory reset type of option. So they may have their own specific server recovery media that you can use. And this can include things like drivers that they need and other things that they want to make sure that you have. So you can kind of do a factory reset type of option if that is provided by the OEM where you purchase the server as well. Now another thing that is gaining a lot of attention and really helps to complement Windows Server Backup is cloud-based backup. So we talk about the Windows Azure Backup, and it is it provides integration into the dashboard, so you can use that same dashboard management interface to control the Azure backup as well as your local server backup. So this is obviously an optional subscription-based service that you can use, but the nice thing is this is a great, easy way to get an off-site copy of those most critical files and folders. You start out by creating a Windows Azure account and then create a backup vault, and then that backup vault has a security certificate that you can then download to your server, and that is used to register your server so you can kind of securely hook up your physical server to your backup service in the cloud. And then there's a wizard that you run to configure the Azure integration and define the different backup settings. So I say that this is a complement to running Windows Server Backup on premises, because this does not allow you to do like a full restore if your hard drives crash or something like that and you want to get the server back from scratch. But this is a great way to have an additional layer of protection, again, for the critical files and folders in the environment that you may want to be able to get at very quickly in the event of some kind of catastrophic event, fire, a flood, or something like that. So really, the recommendation is to use them together. So as we look a little bit closer at what the Windows Azure Backup settings are that are available, as you go through the wizard to configure it, you can add the different folders, the shared folders that you want to protect. So again, this isn't intended to back up the system state or the entire server. This is intended to back up the shared folders that you have that contain the critical data that you want. And so there may be some shared folders that you don't choose to back up. Maybe they have scratch data that's just of a temporary nature or whatever the case may be. So you can select which of those folders that you want. You can also additionally add file history backup. So if you have Windows 8 client computers in the environment, you can use Windows Azure Backup as an additional layer to back up the file history information into the cloud. So that can be great, especially for those very important PCs that you have. And again, it doesn't have to be everybody. You can decide how much of the Windows Azure storage that you want to dedicate to backups, and it just gives you that ability to restore information in more flexible ways. You can, of course, set up a backup schedule. This can be run up to twice a day, so a little less flexible than what you can do with the local backup, but still pretty robust in terms of being able to have multiple backups so that your backup window is fairly short. You can specify the retention policy, so how long should older backup information be retained in the cloud, and of course that's just going to directly impact how much storage you're using and the storage that you're paying for in the service. You can optionally enable some bandwidth utilization parameters, so if you want to do backups during the day, as an example, you might want to go ahead and tweak how much bandwidth the Windows Azure Backup can consume so that end users aren't impacted. So a lot of flexibility then in terms of how you configure the backups. And of course, not only can you set a schedule, but you can manually start a backup as well. And this is primarily used when you're first getting started and want to kick off a backup and see if it's working. But you can certainly do it anytime. Now, the thing that's super popular with the Essentials experience, and again, this was something that was only available with the Essentials edition in the past, but is now something that's available in all environments because you can turn on the Essentials experience as a role in the Standard edition and even the Data Center edition, and that feature is Client Backup. So this ability to automatically get a full backup of client PCs and store those centrally on the server is just a great way to have peace of mind that you're, you know, that information is being backed up. So not only do you have, you know, files and folders, which, you know, in theory should be backed up or should be stored on the server centrally, but you can back up the entire environment. So that means all of the applications that may be installed, all of the, you know, settings and configuration that may go into getting a PC set up just the way you want it, that all gets backed up by client PC backup. So again, it may not be something that you care about for every single client computer in your environment, and that's fine. You can turn this on and off on a per client basis, but the settings that run or control the client PC backup, those settings in terms of the schedule and things like that, retention policy, those are set globally, but then you can choose what locations get backed up on a client PC and whether or not it participates in the client PC backup. So quite a lot of flexibility, and again, the idea is that you have some really robust restore capabilities and your entire environment is protected in ways that really only the Essentials experience is offering in the Windows Server environment. So in terms of turning it on, when you do join a client computer to the Essentials environment by running that Connect Computer Wizard, which we talk about in a future module here, it just kicked off from a web browser, then the client PC is automatically configured to run the client backup. But you can choose, you can go into the dashboard, into the Devices tab, and you could turn off client computer backup for those computers that you may or may not want to, you know, have participate in that. And again, as I mentioned, you can go into the dashboard and configure what the backup schedule should be. So what time window should client computers perform their backup? And again, you can set a retention policy. This just, you know, directly impacts how much storage space is going to be consumed by your backups. Users can also manually initiate a backup. Again, you know, you can have a case where a user works remotely most of the time and comes into the office maybe just occasionally, maybe they're in for a meeting or what have you, and so they can still use the client PC backup if that's something that they want to do to protect that whole, you know, mobile environment by just initiating a backup manually when they are in the office, and then they can go and have their meeting and then come back and it be done. The first backup, again, where it needs to back up every single block, is going to take the longest, but you know, additional backups will only need to protect the changed blocks. So a client backup is quick, just like the server backup is quick. It uses the same type of methodology to do the backups. And then of course this gives you the restore capabilities similar to the Windows Server backup, which is that you can restore individual files and folders, and you can even backup you can even recover the entire computer by doing a bare metal restore. So when it comes to doing or performing the client restore, this does require some administrative assistant. So what the administrator would do would be to go to the client PC that needs to have files restored for it, launch the dashboard from that client PC, so run it as a remote app from the server, and then they would select the items for restore from the backup set. So you can choose by date, you can just select from the list of the backups that have been performed, and then you can choose, just browse through and choose which files and folders that you want to restore. So this is basically just going to mount a backup set and then just copy the files, you know, from the backup set to the local computer that you're sitting in front of. You can also do a full system restore, as I mentioned. There's a couple of ways to initiate that. A new aspect that we have, or a new option that we have to do a full client restore, is actually to do a network boot. So as you set up the Essentials server, the Essentials experience, you have a choice as you're setting up the backup to configure the recovery service, and this all happens automatically. So when you choose that option, it goes and works for a while. It downloads the components of the Windows pre-installation environment that it needs to create a WIM device or a WIM file, a WIM file, and turns on Windows WDS to go ahead and then allow client computers to pixie boot or to network boot. They would discover the WDS server running on your essential server, and then they would be able to boot off of that WIM file, and that that basically just gives you a little menu to say, hey, connect to the essential server, select the PC in the environment that you want to recover, and say go. So it's super easy. As long as the client computer supports pixie boot, you're basically done. It's really, really handy. But you can also create a recovery media, so a USB flash drive, for example, and you can boot the PC off of that, and then you kind of boot into the same similar experience, so that you log into the essential server, select which PC you want to restore, and then go ahead and kick that off. So so really a pretty robust way to get back files and even the entire PC for the environment. And I mentioned this with as it relates to the integration with Windows Azure Backup, but the Essentials experience itself provides file history integration. So with Windows 8 and Windows 8.1 clients that have file history, the Essentials environment, the essential server, can be the destination for file history information for your client PCs. So this allows, you know, instead of having, you know, a local USB device hooked up to every single computer that you have as a way to, you know, be a destination for file history, you can just use the essential server. So this is a little nicer than, it's again, it's kind of a complement to the client PC backup, because you can't do a system state restore. You can only recover files and folders, but it does not need administrative support, so end users can go ahead and use file history to recover accidentally deleted or overwritten files on their own. So so you can kind of use these together, again, in multiple layers of data protection in the environment. Another thing that's kind of new, that is new in the 2012 R2 version here, is that file history integration is now performed on a per user basis as opposed to a per PC basis. And that just allows, you know, if you have multiple people sharing a PC, it just allows the file history information to be tailored, you know, to that individual user. So again, just giving everybody who shares the PC the ability to protect their own data. And it also makes it easy to restore. So if you give a user you know, a new computer, a new laptop or whatever it is, and they log in for the first time, and file history integration is turned on the server, then it will see that the file history is missing from the PC that they're just logging into for the first time. And it can go ahead and synchronize and copy down all the files from the essential server to this new computer. And so the user can get up and going right away with the files and folders that they had, you know, in their documents and their desktop and their libraries and things like that. So by default, media libraries aren't included in the file history. So if you have, you know, big video files or pictures or things like that, then you're going to want to take steps to configure those to be included. And there are going to, of course, be included in the client PC backup that runs as well. So you, again, you can use these two methods to complement each other, and they provide a different protection and restore capabilities. So file history, much like the other backup options, allows you to set the desired frequency, so setting a schedule. You can do file history as much as once every 10 minutes to as infrequently as once per day, and you can also set a retention policy, so there's some flexibility in how much disk space that you consume with file history information. So really, you know, one of the big pain points that businesses have, small businesses, medium-sized businesses, really businesses of all sizes, one of their major pain points is around data protection. They want to make sure that that the data that they produce and consume on a daily basis is protected. And so a lot of effort has gone into that in the Essentials environment to be able to give you a lot of flexibility in how you protect your data and how you can restore it when you need to. So the next thing that I wanted to talk about was just server storage and the and using storage spaces. So storage with the Essentials Edition and with the Essentials Experience running on other edition uses the exact same storage architecture as we have across the entire Windows Server family. So nothing unique or different or special here. It's all the same robust features and the same file sharing protocols and everything like that. So it's the same robust file storage infrastructure that you have. Of course, it has multi-drive support, and it'll do basic software RAID, although storage spaces is gaining more traction as opposed to the older kind of software RAID approach that we have had and continue to have. so you can also use virtual disks and storage spaces. You can use hardware RAID, and there isn't anything to say that you have to use one thing or the other. As an example, storage spaces is designed to protect data volumes, not the operating system volume. So you still might want to use hardware RAID to mirror the OS volume, as an example. But you might want to use storage spaces to give you flexibility and lower costs for your data volumes. So to make them easier to grow, easier to expand, and expand on the fly, and things like that. Things that could be expensive depending on the RAID solution that you might want to purchase, and are a little cheaper or considerably cheaper when you're using storage spaces. But you can combine the two to have the best approach that you want. And if you have a RAID solution that you like and provides the capabilities that you need and that you want, then you can absolutely continue to use a RAID, and that's fully supported in the Essentials environment and in the Windows Server environment in general. So some of the things that Essentials just kind of helps out with, makes it a little bit easier, is a wizard for moving folders from one volume to another, one drive to another. Nothing super secret or magical about this, but it just takes care of all the details in terms of copying the data, assigning the appropriate access control lists, and all these things. It just makes it easier as you're adding, you know, storage to the server. Also, as I mentioned, file history integration, so that's unique with the Essentials experience, and also the ability to recreate some of the predefined folders that we create as part of the setup experience. So like we create a company shared folder that can be used to store documents that are global throughout everybody in the company. You may be creating, you know, shared folders that are specific to departments or whatever, but there are some kind of predefined shared folders that are created, and you can recreate those if the need arises. So I mentioned using storage spaces. Storage spaces is a way to create very flexible, very low cost, and resilient data volumes. The idea is it works on the concept, it's kind of, you can think of it very much as a virtualization technology for your storage devices. Much like Hyper-V is a virtualization technology for your CPUs and your memory. So you can take your physical capacity and you can put it into a pool, and then you could carve it up. In Hyper-V, you carve it up and make virtual machines. In storage spaces, you put your physical storage devices into a pool of resources, and then you create virtual drives that then you can use and format and use just like volumes, just like they were physical volumes. As you create these virtual volumes out of the storage pool, then you can define resiliency options. So you can define no resiliency, or you can do mirroring, or you can do parity if you have three or more devices. You can also, one of the real big benefits of storage spaces is that you can define a virtual disk with thin provisioning. So if you have, for example, two drives in your server, two physical drives, and they're both 1 terabyte drives, but you know that your storage needs continue to grow and grow and grow over time, and you want to plan for that and prepare for that in the future, then you can use thin provisioning to create a virtual disk that has 16 terabytes of capacity in terms of what is seen by Windows Server as the volume size, but it's being backed by you know, either 2 terabytes if you don't use mirroring, or 1 terabyte if you use mirroring for those 2 1-terabyte drives. So you're physically backed by just the capacity of the drives, but you create a virtual disk that seems much larger, and this is thin provisioning. And then as you use up the capacity, when you start to reach the physical capacity, you'll start to see alerts in the dashboard that says, hey, you need to add additional storage, physical storage, to the storage pool, the underlying storage pool that is in use by this virtual disk. And you can do that on the fly, and if you're if your server hardware supports hot add of new physical disks, then you don't even have to turn the server off to go ahead and just add additional capacity. Meanwhile, the virtual disk doesn't need to change at all. It's already defined to be very large. The volumes that, you know, the C drive, the D drive, the E drive, not the C drive, but, you know, the data volumes that you create on this physical disk, they don't need to change. They don't care that anything did or didn't happen. And so then the applications and the shared folders that are running on top of these volumes, they don't need to change at all. So it's super resilient and super expandable in a way that's completely seamless to the users in the environment. So that's really a huge benefit of using storage spaces, so that you can do this idea of dynamically adding storage capacity when you need it, you know, based on your business requirements. So we know that not only does storage needs grow indefinitely over time, but also the price per gigabyte or whatever of storage continues to decline. So if you can set things up initially to be very flexible in adding storage later, then you can just buy storage as you need it at the lowest cost that you can get it at, you know, which is the most current price. So again, it's a complement to RAID solutions that you may want to use. It's not intended to necessarily be the be-all end-all replacement for everything storage, but it does offer some new options, new low-cost, very flexible options. It's basically, again, just kind of virtualization for your storage needs. So when it comes to expanding the storage in your server, as you add a new drive to the server, then an alert is shown. You have an unformatted hard drive, and you can choose to use that as you want. So right from within the alert console, you can go ahead and click on a link to go ahead and assign that. It can be added to a storage pool if you're using storage spaces. It can be designated as a backup destination if you've, you know, connected an external removable drive. It can be just defined as a normal volume. So it's pretty easy to use new devices as they're added to the system and to be alerted to that. So another aspect of server storage that I wanted to talk about, this is new in Windows Server 2012 R2 Essentials and the Essentials experience, is an enhancement to our Office 365 integration. So if you choose to use an Office 365 subscription and integrate that into the environment, then now you can more easily use SharePoint libraries in the environment. So you would be able to see the different SharePoint libraries in the dashboard, just like you see your server folders, and you can use the dashboard to create these and manage them, assign permissions and things like that. There are multiple different library types that you can create, so the most common being document libraries, which you would just put, you know, your normal documents. You can also create a library that's a little bit tailored to store pictures, and you can create a wiki page library, and that can act as kind of a informational repository for the company. So when you are using you know, the document libraries, that's very much from an end user perspective, very much like using shared folders. And we talk about this a little bit more when we talk specifically about managing client computers, and also in the user experience module later on in this series. So I won't go super deep into this now. But there's a lot of benefits that you have when using SharePoint libraries. You get very sophisticated versioning, and of course you can set permissions in very much the same way. So this is a great new aspect for storage in the Essentials environment. And again, I'll cover more about this in future modules, so please join me for that. I also wanted to just briefly go over the shared folders and creating shared folders in the environment, how that works. So this is a pretty straightforward task. Much like the way that we have simplified the creation of user accounts in an Essentials environment by bubbling up the most important and impactful aspects or attributes or properties of user accounts, we do very much the same thing with shared folders. So shared folders are not difficult to create, and we just make it a little easier in the Essentials environment. So really, as you create a new shared folder, you only need to provide some very basic information: what the name of the folder is, what volume that you want to use to store that, and then assign user and group permissions. So groups are new to 2012 R2 for the Essentials experience. And again, this is really most useful in larger environments. So when you run the Essentials experience as a role in Standard and Data Center, you can have more than the 25 users that the Essentials Edition is limited to. So as you get, you know, quite a few users, it becomes much easier to control access to resources using security groups rather than individual users. So that has been added as an enhancement for the 2012 R2 version. So you can do that as you're creating your shared folders. And then finally, you want to designate whether or not you want to include the new shared folder in server backup. So that's an important step to go ahead and do as you're creating the new storage locations. You can also, after the fact, after you have created a shared folder, you can go back and adjust its properties. So here you can go and rename the folder. You can give it a description, update its description. You can set a quota threshold. So this is a new capability in R2 as well, where you can generate warnings warning alert in the dashboard that you can see if a shared volume exceeds a particular size. So it won't block users from being able to store information into a particular folder, but it can give you an indication that you are reaching the planned capacity that you expected for that particular shared folder. So again, this is a great way to proactively purchase new storage capacity and install that in the server before things go badly because you've run out of disk space. And of course, you can modify permissions after the fact. You can also choose to whether or not you want to hide this particular shared folder or a particular shared folder from remote access, from the remote web access and the different web services that that can allow users to access these remotely. So if you just want to trim those out from the user's experience based on security policies that you have, you can go ahead and choose to hide a shared folder that way. And again, as I mentioned, we have the ability to very easily move a shared folder. So again, no super magic here. It's just a convenience factor. You could totally move your own folders manually by just copying from one folder to another, resetting all the ACLs exactly as they need to be and in the way you want them to be. Or you can just launch the Move Folder Wizard and pick the new drive that you want to use and say go. So just an easy way to do that. And just to make sure that everything happens exactly as it needs to, no steps are forgotten, and everything is ready to go. So one thing to note is as you move the folder from one volume to another volume, you may need to adjust your server backup settings to make sure that shared folder is now being protected on the new volume where it lives. So that's a little bit about managing the essential server. I want to just finish up with some links to some great resources that we have. We have a ton of additional technical information available on the Windows Server Essentials Tech Center, so please do check that out. We have a very active blog, so highly encourage you to check out our blog. An RSS feed is a great way to go to stay current on that. We have the development team posting information on features. We have the customer service and support folks posting information about things that you may need to know to resolve issues in the environment. We also do marketing blog posts about new products and new things to be aware of. So it's a great blog with a lot of information from a lot of different aspects of using Essentials and the Essentials experience. We also have a very active support forum. So not only is this monitored by our dev team, but we have a great community of MVPs that help us out and read through these and help answer questions and help alert us to questions that need, you know, additional attention. And then, of course, we have our product pages. So both for Windows Server 2012 R2 all up, as well as a page for the Essentials Edition specifically. And you can find things like data sheets and white papers, and you can also find the link to the trial version, so you can download those and get started playing around. I also wanted to just make you aware of some of our partner resources for the partners who are watching. We have a great campaign in the Ahead of the Game campaign, a number of different resources that you can use to help inform your customers and things like that. So I wanted to just include that. We have a number of other partner resources I wanted to just include as reference in the deck today. And also information about how to buy Windows Server 2012 R2. So again, this is just mostly for your reference. We have a number of different links around product and licensing resources, so please do take advantage of those to answer any questions that you have. And then finally, we have a number of different programs, licensing programs that are appropriate for the small and mid-sized business to use. So again, wanted to include that for your reference. So thank you very much for joining me for this presentation in our series on Windows Server 2012 R2 and the Essentials experience, and I hope you'll join us for additional presentations in the series.